MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. And as we're recording this here on Friday, October 2nd, we are receiving news that the President of the United States, who has tested positive for the SARS-CoV-2 virus and has now come down with COVID-19 symptoms, is being transported to Walter Reed Medical Center. We've also learned that First Lady Melania Trump has also tested positive. And we found here through Sean Conley, the president's physician, that the president has been taking supplements of zinc, vitamin D, famotidine, melatonin, and daily aspirin. In addition, we also learned that the president has already received a single 8-gram dose of Regeneron's polyclonal antibody cocktail. Now, we've talked about this before in terms of the course of the disease, and we got some pretty good data early on that here we have the population of the patients, and what I call the first phase is where infection occurs. And then what follows after symptoms begin is phase two. Now, it's in this phase two that the immune system either improves the situation and the patient gets better, or in about 20% of cases, the infection persists and continues and progresses over approximately a 7-day course. Those 20% of patients, of the symptomatic ones, will go into what we call phase three, where they require hospitalization. And normally, patients require hospitalization when their oxygen levels start to drop, typically on a pulse oximeter when they start to drop below 89%. That's also when patients may need to have intensive care services or even be placed on the ventilator. And then if the disease progresses, finally on to death. Now, we've talked about this before, but one of the key things that allows the patients to get better 80% of the time is the patient's immune system. And this is where the president currently is at this point. Now, we are told that he is being transported to Walter Reed Medical Center. It's unclear whether or not the patient requires oxygen at this point or whether or not they just want to transfer the patient out of an abundance of caution. Here's an analysis that looked at over 100 studies taking data from around the world, looking at the risk of children, young adults, and adults and the elderly. And you can see here that the estimated probability of death if infected with coronavirus at the age of 74 would be around 4%, or 1 in 25. And you can see that it goes up from there. Indeed, someone who is 74 years of age would have 5 times the rate of complications compared to someone who is 18 to 29. And in terms of death, the number goes to 90-fold. Now, Trump does have some risk factors that would elevate that 4% even higher. Number one, he's a male. And number two, he is overweight. The president's physical examination, which was done earlier this year on June 3rd, 2020, shows that the president's weight is 244 pounds and his height is 6'3", which puts his BMI at around 30.5. This would put the president at the low end of the obesity scale. What's pretty amazing to me is that his last physical, however, said that his blood pressure was 121 over 79. For someone who's 74 years of age, that's a pretty good blood pressure given his job. And of course, the other thing is that, well, he's the president of the United States, which means he's going to get top-notch care quickly. As we saw with Boris Johnson, time will tell us which direction things are going to go. Now, as we have mentioned, the immune system is very important here during this phase two, as I like to call it. And according to many of the studies, patients on average spend about 7 days during phase two before those that progress do progress to hospitalization and on to death potentially. And this article that was published recently in Science tries to explain why in at least 14% of these severe COVID-19 cases, that would be the case. And it seems as though there are two papers that in both cases show how the body's immune response can be crippled by certain diseases. And if you read, you'll see that scientists were actually onto this quite some time ago back in June. Interferon responses could explain susceptibility to severe COVID-19. So to understand how this works, you have to understand what interferon is. And there's a nice graph down here that explains it. Essentially, interferon is the way that cells communicate with each other that there is a virus loose. and it allows cells to upregulate proteins which can defend it against the virus and also kill the virus. So you can see here that there are uninfected cells that can actually detect the virus outside and produce interferons, and there's also infected cells that can detect the virus outside or inside and produce these interferons. There's type 1 interferons, which are represented by these yellow diamonds, and there's also type 3 interferons. And these type 3 interferons, they signal back to the epithelial cells and tell them to turn on these antiviral genes. However, what they're concerned about is that the virus can block the stimulation of these interferon genes, block the stimulation of antiviral genes by interferon, and also block function of antiviral gene products. Well, it seems as though that theory is bearing out, because this was published here on September 24th, an article in Science titled Inborn Errors of Type 1 Interferon Immunity in Patients with Life-Threatening COVID-19. And what they found was that a gene mutation responsible for interferon was detected in many of these patients with severe COVID-19. Specifically, they showed that human fibroblasts with mutations affecting this pathway that was coded for in these genes are vulnerable to SARS-CoV-2 inborn errors of TLR3 and IRF7 dependent type 1 interferon. Now, those are the proteins that were coded by the genes with the mutations. The other article, titled Autoantibodies Against Type 1 Interferons in Patients with Life-Threatening COVID-19. And in this article, as you get older, it seems, antibodies actually bind this interferon and prevent it from doing what it's supposed to do. You can see here one of the titles, the autoantibodies neutralize the interferon alpha 2 and the interferon omega in vitro. In this study here, you can see that when you looked at healthy controls, these antibodies were essentially negative for antibodies against these specific interferons, whereas the life-threatening COVID-19 and neutralizing anti-IFN alpha-2 autoantibodies, we could see here that they were either intermediate or high. Same thing over here, where we see that most of the life-threatening COVID-19 and neutralizing anti-IFN alpha-2 antibodies were elevated in these patients. However, in healthy controls, they were almost always negative, indicating that these autoantibodies seem to predict how the patients are going to do from a prognosis standpoint. And here is another graph that also explains it. Here we see on the x-axis different mutations from the first study that show that when you have these mutations, whether they be autosomal recessive or autosomal dominant, the level of interferon is going to be low in these situations because the cascade of protein that basically makes this interferon is going to be disrupted because of the mutations. Whereas over here, in this blue graph, we can see these are autoantibodies negative, so there's no antibodies, and these don't have the loss of function variants, which means that all of the genes are working perfectly and there's no antibodies. Notice how high the blue dots are. In other words, there's plenty of interferon that's around and available. In the far right graph, we see the autoantibodies positive without loss of function variants. So here, clearly, they are low again. So what this graph is showing is that in order to have a good interferon response, you have to make sure that you have no loss of function variants, in other words, no mutations in your genes, and you have to have no autoantibodies. If you have either mutations, which are those six on the left, or you have autoantibodies, which is that graph on the right, both of those situations could cause your interferon levels to be low and predispose you to having a very severe COVID-19 course. And this would seem to indicate that at least in a minority of severe COVID-19 cases worldwide, that there may be a place for supplemental interferon, or at least a way of getting interferon levels up and activated. So the hypothesis is raised, is it possible that the reason why some people are on the 80% and some are on the 20% might have to do with how well of a response the immune system has with respect to interferons and the innate immune system? And I think the answer there is yes. And we've talked about supporting the immune system way back in our MedCram update number 47, where there seemed to be anecdotal evidence that hydrotherapy used in some sanitariums at the beginning of the last century may have reduced the death rate in inpatients in those sanitariums. This hydrotherapy used hot water followed by cold water. And we explored some of these issues in not only that update, but also update 46. And given now that we've seen that the interferon response may be beneficial, at least in COVID-19, or its absence may be deleterious in COVID-19, it goes without saying that it might be important to see here that we've got a paper published in 1988, which shows that hyperthermia in humans enhances interferon gamma synthesis and alters the peripheral lymphocyte population. Now, in this paper, it freely admits that much of the data prior to this was in vitro. However, they attempted to see what would happen to gamma interferon synthesis in vivo as they heated up subjects. And as you can see here, as we increase the core body temperature right above what we consider a fever at 38.0, once we go to 39, we see that the amount of gamma interferon skyrockets, and we have very good levels at that point. We can also see here with hyperthermia that there was a 27% increase in total WBCs, or white blood cells, and there was a 39.5% increase in granulocytes, and also increases in eosinophils and lymphocytes, but a mild decrease in monocytes. The authors go on to say here that the observed increase in gamma interferon may be a byproduct of a cascading mechanism in which interleukin-1 production is enhanced, stimulating the production of interleukin-2, which in turn would stimulate gamma interferon induction. Preliminary data indicate that IL-2 levels also increase the PHA-stimulated lymphocytes, and natural killer cell activity is enhanced by in vivo hyperthermia. Thus, these factors may be involved in gamma interferon enhancement. What I would find very interesting is to see whether or not in our former studies that showed that these mutations prevented the increase of interferon, the interferon response, whether or not hyperthermia would bypass these blockages and allow the interferon levels to rise. And notwithstanding President Trump's departure to Walter Reed Medical Center, it's clear that the president is in this, quote, phase two of the infection. And apparently the president got an 8-gram dose of Regeneron's polyclonal antibody cocktail. And this is basically a collection of antibodies that are designed to bind the virus and prevent further infection in the patient. So what's the data on this Regeneron antibody cocktail that the president received? Here's an article posted today. And in that study that included 275 patients, the top dose of the treatment relieved symptoms in the subjects more quickly than placebo for those patients that didn't need to be hospitalized. And the company said that they were going to try to repeat this trial in a larger study to confirm these findings. And as the president here is taking off and going to Walter Reed Medical Center, my advice to him and anybody who has COVID-19 positivity but not yet sick enough to be admitted to the hospital is to, number one, rest, get plenty of sleep, try not to treat a fever if it's possible because we've seen evidence that an elevated temperature can improve the interferon response. For those of you who are interested, I invite you to look at MedCram updates 46 and 47, and to continue the supplements such as vitamin D, zinc, and other things that we've covered and I've covered in update 59. So this is a breaking news update, and please stay tuned for further updates as we follow what occurs here with the president and hope that he gets better soon. Thanks for joining us.
And don't forget to see all of our MedCram videos at our website, medcram.com. We'll see you next time.